Sexbots and the men who love them. Okay. Sexbot 2050 is the indie sci-fi that explores if realistic androids were a real thing, would we as human beings fall in love with them? Probably. We follow David Vaughn's Michael Green, who as of late has been a bit unsatisfied with his marriage. After visiting his brother-in-law, played by Devin Fuller, one night, who has recently acquired a sexbot, or e-mate, Michael becomes intrigued by the idea of a synthetic mate. And from there, stuff happens. Things don't necessarily spiral out of control or anything, but things do happen in a more realistic way if something like this was possible. I, as the people in the movie do, make the joke about sexbots. But in this world, that's not really all they are. Yes, we're led to believe that that is a big part of their function, but they're actually mates. They're people that, some of these people that have a hard time talking with other people out in the world, they have made so that they can go out and spend time with. They're concubines, but they're, you know, concubines and mates that whenever they want, they fuck in really weird ways. Which, let's be honest, that's how it would be in real life. Upon finally acquiring one of these e-mates, Michael starts to develop feelings for her. And of course, this creates more of a rift in his marriage. The movie asks a lot of questions, such as, can we, as human beings, love a synthetic person? Is that love real? Is it genuine? Or is it more of a God complex or a lust thing? Is having sex with a synthetic human being really cheating on a real human being? Can you have both? These are a few of the interesting questions that this movie brings up. And the answers aren't always what you expect. I'll give this movie one thing, if nothing else. It does get you to thinking about this subject. And while it is sci-fi, it's not really that far off from where we'll probably be at some point in the near future. I mean, we already have rudimentary robots that look fairly humanoid that people are out there fucking right now. Granted, they're not nearly as sophisticated as the ones in this movie, but we're not really that far off in the grand scheme of things, I think. Like I said, the movie has a very interesting premise and a really intriguing story. Unfortunately, it just takes a really long fucking time to get to the point. This movie is a lot longer than it should be. I get that they're kinda sorta going for a bit of an art house indie vibe, but it doesn't change the fact that there are parts where you're just kinda bored out of your mind. There's scenes that are twice as long, if not longer, than they should be, where the camera just like focuses on one thing and just sits there and watches it. In some movies, this approach works. In this one, it does not. Case in point, there's a part where a character needs to go talk to another character, and they need to go to this character's office. Now, in most cases, at most, it would show them get up, walk to the door, transition, and then they would arrive in the office. But not in 2050. They want you to see the walk in all its glory. The fact that the journey to get from where they were to this person's office has absolutely no bearing whatsoever on anything at all doesn't really matter here. And it takes them like a minute or two to get there, which you're probably saying, it's a minute or two, so what? Well, when you're sitting there watching characters walk through a warehouse and like nothing else is going on, they're just walking through a plain warehouse, that's it. For a minute or two, it seems like 5 to 10 fucking minutes. Shots like this are throughout this movie. There are parts and scenes that are just drawn out way too fucking long. It seems like they were trying to pad the runtime, which does make sense because this idea and the movie really seems like it was a short story that they extended out to full length. A shorter version of this, even a 35 to 45 minute long version, would have been superior in every single way. And I know that means you can't call yourself full length, you can't enter into some festivals and stuff unless it is full length, but at the expense of the story and the final product, that is what they should have done. Just shorten this down to a much shorter product. The movie does have some things to say. It has a lot of social commentary within it. Some of it subtle, some of it not so much. Unfortunately, like the story itself, it's just drowned out by these overextended scenes. By the time you get to the meat on the bones, you kinda don't care at that point. And when it comes to the more in-your-face commentary that they have in the film, it's just too much. Like, they go from very subtle messaging to in-your-fucking-face, shove-it-down-your-throat messages. All that aside, though, I will say that the movie does have a good message about technology and what it's doing to our humanity. And the ending, while a bit unorthodox, is more realistic to how I think something like this could possibly play out. It unfortunately just takes a really long fucking time to get there. The performances are all pretty good, and in honesty, for an indie flick, they're actually a lot better than you would expect. They're not perfect, and you can tell there's a few parts that people are just reading lines, but as a whole, they're all pretty good here. There's not many faces that you'd be familiar with here. Of course, as they advertise everywhere for this movie, Dean Cain shows up in a bit part. His performance is fine. I mean, it might be a smidge smidge better than everybody else's, but it's nothing great, but it's not bad either. It fits, it's fine. The one standout amongst everyone else will be the young woman who plays the character that runs the juice shop. I looked online and couldn't find the name of the actress that plays her, but she is a step above everybody else here. It's a bit part, so she's not there long, but when she does show up, she does bring an energy and realism to the role that everybody else is lacking. In other words, they're all acting and she's actually performing. I'm not talking Oscar caliber work here or anything, but she does bring something more to the screen than everybody else. Overall though, everybody does do a fairly good job here. The movie looks really good for its extremely low budget as well. There's not a lot in the way of special effects in this movie. The most that I could see was whenever it shows like the skyline of the city, you see like shit tons of drones. But besides that, there's not a whole lot in the special effects department that I could pick out. But what is there does look pretty good. And the movie as a whole, the way it's shot and composed and everything, just looks pretty good. From a technical standpoint, the movie's very competent. Overall, there's an interesting story that's asking intriguing questions that I think are going to be coming up more and more in real world society as time goes on. However, the movie's just a lot longer than it should be and becomes a slog to get through at times. And that unfortunately drowns out the interesting questions and points this movie brings up. I was pretty satisfied with the way the movie ended. It didn't go the direction I was expecting, but the hour and a half leading up to that conclusion was so erratic in its pacing that I don't know if most people will get there. And because of that, if this sounds like it could be interesting to you, at best, I would say, check it out on Netflix. This movie really does have some interesting ideas to it, but just be prepared if you're gonna watch it to wade through the extended scenes of nothingness. So there it is, guys, my review of 2050. If you enjoyed and want more content like this, hit that subscribe button and help my little channel grow. If you liked what I had to say, give me a thumbs up. If not, let me know in the comments below why. And as always, stay sexy, Nashville.
According to a pair of New Zealand researchers, sex robots are the future of prostitution.
Weird.
So really, ask yourself this question. If the robots in this movie really did exist and they were as realistic as they are in this movie, what would you do? I don't expect anybody to actually give an honest answer here, but let's think about that for a minute. Put that in your brain, give it a thought. If they were that real, what would you do? What?